Okay, we are now live. For anyone watching, thank you for watching. I thank Flavio and Luke for joining me. We will be playing Fate Core in the setting, which is still unnamed. It's based on the artwork. Just a second. By Jakub Różalski, or something like that. His work is very beautiful, and I will post it, link to it in the description on YouTube, and I think I already did in pretty much every event description and every promotional post I made. So that should be all here. We will be pretty much considering pictures as an inspiration. They don't automatically translate into statements. Basically, we may decide that, for instance, giant shogun that's cutting Japanese warriors may or may not exist, but most of the stuff, like, that is the coolest part, Star Wars mechs, well, actually, steampunk version of Star Wars mechs will be there, and characters with animals will be there. Before Luke arrived, we, Flavio and myself, discussed a bit. So I would like one of you to take over a character who has a mech, and the other one to take a character who has an animal at their side, and they should basically work for Bolsheviks.
Yeah, I wanted the one with the mech.
I don't mind having an animal.
Okay, but that means, well, okay, it's, if you don't want an animal, then you can play a basic footman, mechanic, or cavalry soldier. Anyway, that's the basic idea. I'll let more or less everything run in according to basic Fate Core rules, meaning there will be no, at least not at this point, explicit rule hacks. Meaning base, you have keep your basic stress, you keep your basic consequences and everything. I did prepare the skill list because that has proved necessary, and I will post it in your chat now. You are expected to think of your character, hopefully in parallel, while we do a bit of collaborative setting creation, or perhaps, should I say, setting customization. Meaning I plan to do sparks Q&A phase before we start. Every time I tried it, and I tried it actually twice by now, once with the serious role players, to fantastic both success and amusement during the Spark session, and also I tried it once with two of my nephews, age 11 and 13, and both times it worked perfectly, like a charm, and gave us a much more interesting setting than we had to begin with. Anyway, Sparks session, Sparks Q&A functions in the following way. Every one of us, that is including myself, including the GM, has two tokens. They call it Sparks points or something like that. Doesn't matter, you can think of them as fate points. And by paying the token, you buy privilege, you buy GM privileges on one issue, which is started by asking a question. That means that person who bought the privilege decides what stays in from the other players' recommendations and what goes out. It means that everyone may offer suggestions, but the final arbiter is the person who paid the Spark token. The rules also include two minor details, that it may not contradict any previously established facts. And the second rule is that it may not contradict things mentioned in the question. So if I mention some fact during the asking of questions, then the answer may not contradict that. For instance, sometimes ago, we did a collaborative creation of a setting where we already had elves, and we had Trickrin. If you've played Dungeons and Dragons, you probably know what these are. If don't, it's not too important. But the question was, with elves nearly extinct, what do Trickrin now eat? And that basically meant that during asking of question, I established that elves were on brink of extinction, and that Trickrins eat elves, or at least used to eat elves. And the guy answering the question paid the Sparks token and gave the answer. They like to eat brains of the mammals, and especially brains of dolphins are considered delicacy, which brings the Trickrin to a bad reputation with sailors, because sailors believe that dolphins bring good luck. And we established all these facts into the answer, and we wrote them down, and it created very interesting setting. Since we don't have too many established facts in this game, including somewhat obscure geography and stuff like that. I think it would be very useful to flesh down some hard facts which are important to us. The idea is then to tie those facts with your aspects and stunts and character stories and to start playing from that point. I hope it is clear. And also, final rule was that usually GM asks the first question for free, and the person who asked the first question for free answers the last question. So this is how the system works, and this will be done either together or before character creation. As far as I'm concerned, if you have any idea what you would like to see regarding your characters, I encourage you to mention them now, and we will go from there.
Okay. I personally would like to have characters, one high concept that I'm thinking of would be a Romanian mercenary that studied mechanics so that he can repair his mech. So I would like to include Romanians in.
Yeah, well, geography is close enough. I expected that. I'm perfectly okay. Also, a character who is both a mechanic and a pilot is very useful in the setting because...
I'm not a pilot. I'm a mercenary. So...
Yeah, but you should drive that mech, right?
Oh, of course. you mean pilot the mech. Okay.
Yeah, pilot of the mech, as in pilots of Formula 1, etc. Sorry. Driver of the mech.
I understand now. It's more like a mercenary that knows how to both repair and... drive the mech. That's what you're saying.
Okay. That's perfectly fits my idea of the setting. Luke?
I was kind of thinking for my high concept, it was a Polish Hussar.
I beg your pardon?
I don't know how far past that I've gotten, really.
I'm sorry, I didn't understand what you said for the high concept.
Polish Hussar, the...
Wrong side. Bolsheviks.
Oh, Bolsheviks. There were... Wait.
I mean, Hussars are cool, no questions, but I'll openly admit I have a problem seeing Russia from Polish perspective.
I'm not as familiar with German. I have a North American.
Okay,
idea.
Yeah. Cossacks work, and despite what popular culture says, some of them did actually switch side to Reds during the war. And so there is actually the entire Bolshevik Polish war was not entirely, but major part was fought of the horseback. And since horsemen appear very prominently on the illustration, I could definitely do Bolshevik cavalryman, if that would be okay for you.
If that works.
Okay. Anything else? Any aspect you want to add during the play? You're pretty much free. You may also pick the ethnicity, as we had plenty of people from other ethnicities pretty much fighting in the war and occasionally switching sides, because the Bolsheviks during the time were very adept at recruiting prisoners of war and even enemies to their cause. And that is something of an option. You can always play in American communist or some like George Orwell type who came from God knows where because he believed in proletariat revolution and all the stuff. And pretty much at the start, I will openly admit that I will do a bit of romanticizing Bolsheviks in this particular situation, in this particular game, and not because I pretty much like Bolsheviks, far from it. It's just that I really loved the portrayal. Well, actually, these are not Bolsheviks. In the illustration, these are Polish soldiers, but to me, they looked like Bolsheviks. And since, again, I have problem watching pretty much any conflict between the Russians and Polish. From Polish perspective, I decided to, turn the blind eye a bit and twist them into Bolsheviks. Of course, now that we're mentioning our ethnicities, I am from Serbia, and we had our own, let's just say, communist period, and this illustration, how do I put it, used my love of Star Wars to kick the nostalgia for that period art, and that's what I would like to explore in this game.
Okay, so what's the first question?
Okay, I will. I'll ask the first question. I'll just see if everyone is okay and if everyone has understood it so far. I will also give you an opportunity to add some. Each, both of you individually, before we start, one thing or one concept which is not in the pictures, or remove something which we saw during the illustration, and the questions and the answers will not be able to contradict that. So, for instance, if you want to add, I don't know, mobile phone or earpieces or something like that, you can, if you want to have aliens or some sort of magical powers on something like that, that's perfectly okay. If you want to veto something, like there will be absolutely no religious miracles in this game, this will be also something you have as your prerogative, and neither I nor the other players will be able to contradict that. So anyway, each of you have one thing you can add and one thing you can remove.
Okay. I do want to have not the cell phones, but more like you know those phones that they have in Macs where it looks like a landline, but you are connected to kind of a radio, and you still need to input your numbers in there, but you need to change the frequency so that you can actually get signal, so to speak.
It's okay, so you want some sort of telecommunication between the Macs, and you want the big, huge telephone speakers.
Yeah, because the way I see it, in the Mac, you could have a space, kind of like the way a telecommunications officer would have, only the Mac would be small enough for just one person, so it's up to the person that's there to actually change the frequency so that they could actually phone the next Mac next to them or phone back to base, depending
on... Okay, that works perfectly for me. You want to veto something out?
No.
Okay.
Adding something to the setting?
Yeah.
I'm not sure.
Okay, well, if you want to think about for a few moments, I will add something for myself. And I will add one very important thing. Jewish magic. Only Jews are right. Only Jewish God really exists. And they can do a bit of Kabbalah and stuff like that. And, of course, nobody else believes it. Neither most of the Jews believes in that, but that's something to be debated during the Sparks phase. But I want to add, there is Jewish, superstition, Kabbalah actually works. And well, at least parts of Jewish religion are true. Meanwhile, everything else, Christianity, Islam, everything else is just superstition.
Okay. So, what do you remove?
I don't think I'll necessarily remove anything explicitly at this point. I might change my mind sometimes later. But that can be done through the questions and answers.
Okay.
Luke, do you want something to add before I make my first official question?
How big a change can we make?
As long as neither Flavio nor myself have a problem, you can make pretty much anything you want. You can have Americans having nuclear weapons already. You can have it. You can explicitly say that geography has nothing to do with real one, whatever.
Okay, I have an idea.
Okay.
Grigori Rasputin was never murdered.
Works perfectly for me. Excellent idea. I like it. I like it.
Okay. I want to see where this is going. And
instead of him being murdered, there was a reformation of the Orthodox Church that moved more towards his ideas.
Okay, you will have to enlighten me about his ideas, because I'm an Orthodox and I don't know much about what the fuck, pardon my language, what he wanted. But I really like him being introduced into the setting, because he is a very iconic character, so to speak, for the era.
It was mostly more openness about sexuality. So instead of it being them being closed off and kind of like.
I love both Orthodox faith and sexuality, so I don't have a problem with that. You want to add more detail to that, or do we leave that to Q&A?
We'll leave that to Q&A, I think.
Okay. I'm good with everything so far, so go for it.
Okay. And in light of your idea, I will modify my first question, and my question will be, what happened to the Emperor, and did Rasputin have anything to do with it? And you may think about who wants to answer this while I type the question in the chat, because we will need to return to the questions.
Okay. What might happen to...
I'm gonna ask you to refrain from commenting until either of you decide to spend a point. If you don't want to spend a point, I will probably leave the question unresolved and I will ask another one.
Okay, just put it in the chat so I can think about it first, okay?
Okay. Okay, gentlemen, does anyone wants to answer that, or do I leave that question unresolved? I mean, you can, if you pay the token, that means you can have Emperor alive and well, directing white forces. You can have pay and say something like, he was murdered by Bolsheviks, or you can go something outlandish and say, well, actually Emperor and Lenin were in on it together all the way and everything was staged, or something like that.
Okay, I'm spending one.
Okay.
What happened to the Emperor was, he was used by, since he was a political prisoner, he was used by Rasputin's forces to experiment on new prosthetics and cybernetic augmentation, so that his...
We have a cyber emperor!
So that the populace could benefit from the various... Because everyone might just, because of the war, people get their arms cut off or legs cut off or what have you, and the Bolsheviks experimented on the Emperor so that they'd make better prosthetics for the populace.
Okay, so we have a bit of cyberpunk added in it. So, okay, do you want to maybe clarify how available prosthetics are, or do you want to leave it for the next question, or leave it unresolved?
Well, to be fair, the Emperor is an experiment, so it really depends on how far and how crazy Rasputin wants to actually experiment on the Emperor. It really depends on him.
Since you paid a point for this, you may decide this or leave it for the later point, later time.
Well, I leave it as a separate question as to how much the science has progressed so that, or something along those lines.
Okay. Well, you want to type these things you established in the chat, so we have a... record. You should say something like, the Rasputin is experimenting on the Emperor for prosthetics and something like that. Okay. Did we establish anything else beyond this? I think it's pretty much enough for the first answer. Then you can write something, your first question, and say it something like Q1 or something like that.
Okay, so my turn to answer.
Mm-hmm. To ask.
Okay. So Q1.
You don't have to type it.
Well, what I was going to ask is, did the Bolsheviks have airplanes as advanced as their mech technology? That's my question.
Well, I'm gonna go and fix myself a drink. So I'll put the pause button for a minute. I forgot that before we started broadcasting. And by that time, Luke will have time to decide whether he wants to spend his point. And by the time I get back, if Luke does not spend his point, I will.
So the question was, if they have as advanced airplane technology as they do their mechs.
Yes. And do you want to spend a point to actually answer it?
I think I will spend a point to answer.
Okay.
I'm going to say that their airplane technology isn't as advanced as their mech technology. But elsewhere it might be.
Okay. I'm going to type it in chat. Okay, and you type your answer in chat.
Am I dealing with the N key on my keyboard that it won't go down all the way?
Faulty keyboard then.
Yeah, it's on a laptop too, so it's not like I can do very much about it.
I know.
Folks, I'm back. Luke, do you want to spend point to answer that, or do you want me? Because I will answer this.
I did spend a point.
Okay. And then please repeat the answer because I wasn't able to hear you.
Airplanes in this version of Leninist, Communist, Marxist Russia, is their airplanes are not as advanced as their mechs are, but in other countries they might be.
Okay. Here's the suggestion. Not necessary. You don't have to accept it, but I was always having this idea, which would be pretty cool, that occasionally some sort of airplanes, or rather spaceships, occasionally drop some of those mechs and leave them there. And basically, humans have no real idea who made them, but they discovered how to use them, and if you know what I mean.
I like that idea. So, in that case, then, pretty much what you said, but I'm going to slightly change it a little bit, in that they weren't used to making airplanes, they instead tried to make Zeppelins.
I like it. Basically, we've established that Air Force of the Bolsheviks is somewhat backwards compared to the other nations. And we've established that there are some sort of, well, we as players would call them spaceships, but there would be some sort of airships from the point of characters, and that they deliver the mechs, right?
Yep.
Pretty much.
Okay. You wanna post that in the chat, Luke? Mm-hmm. And maybe ask you a question.
So it was, oh, yeah. That's essentially just what I got from it.
Okay.
My question is, since the time the era is around 1918, 1920, or actually, no, I'll word my question a little bit better. How involved was this version of Russia in World War One, or was there even a World War One?
I will answer that question. And I know it's a bit underwhelming, but I will keep things pretty historic. After all, it makes us subs important. So, we will keep the facts as they are, in sense that World War One did happen, that Bolsheviks did pull out of World War One before everyone else defeated Germany. And I don't know if it's really important that Serbia was in the center of everything, but as it for I'm not sure how Luke is with geography, but it's even further from Russia than Romania, so we can keep Serbia off the map. But we will establish that. Additional details, I'm a bit fuzzy. In sense, it may not have ended yet, but it's pretty much sure and decided that British and the French will eventually win with substantial, well, substantial, with help of Americans, Japanese, or who not. And I want to keep pretty much, well, not everything as planned, but most important historical fact, for instance, that Germany will, Nazism will eventually appear in Germany as a consequence of the unfair treatment of Germany at the end of the war. But I am open for any changes in the war. Basically, anything either of you want to change in minor detail, I am open to suggestions.
Well, this is a suggestion on my part, but maybe I don't know how to phrase this well. From what I remember from history, Romania was among those countries that won World War One.
Yeah. That is correct. If it matters to you, as far as I remember, Romania started on the side of Entente, but after the defeat of Serbia, Romania was pretty much defeated also and forced by Austria-Hungary to change sides, and forced by Austria-Hungary to switch sides, and briefly they fought on the side of Central Powers, but again with collapse of Bulgaria, and as the changes started happening on Thessalonica front, and then it became apparent that allies would win the war, they switched the sides again. This is again my memory. And one other thing I remember is that during the Versailles Agreement, Romania was represented among the winning nations. So,
yeah, because World War One, Romania was among the nations that won. World War Two was the one where Romania was represented as lost, even though they switched side midway through.
Okay, so but what was your suggestion?
But what I wanted for at least this time period is more like the provinces, Moldova, Tsaromenska, and Transylvania would actually, you know, Moldova, Vahia, and Transylvania would actually unite with their whole bits, and there won't be just a separate faction of Moldova in resulting. It's just a pure full Romania, you know?
Okay, so basically meaning Moldova, you keep that, and you want to make Romania a bit bigger than it is now, Is that the suggestion? Okay, I don't have a problem with that. That's okay. Do you want to change something more concrete into the dead conduct of the war? For instance, do you want to have them neutral but selling their services to either side or something like that?
Well, their conduct within the war is more the way I would see it in this new universe. They'd be sort of like Switzerland, but not really, you know?
Okay.
They themselves would not participate in the war proper after they've united all of the provinces into one big Romania.
Okay.
And after that point, they'd only sell their mercenaries as usual, but as a country, they've achieved their goal.
Okay. Can I make a proposal? How would you like? Can we say that Romania was the first country to recognize Bolsheviks?
Sure.
Okay. For anyone, if they really care, Turkey was the first country. Mustafa Kemal's regime needed allies abroad, and he needed recognition, and Bolsheviks needed recognition, so they made peace and they divided Caucasus between themselves. Anyway, that's not really important. Okay, time for my second question. What is the interest of Swiss Jews in this war as opposed to local Jews?
I don't understand.
Okay, what is the... The question is, where do interests of Swiss Jews as in Jews from Switzerland, differ? Where are they, in what aspects are they different than the interest of the local Jews in Russia? That area. I mean, there is basically a myth, which, as far as I can tell, is absolutely false. Pretty much every side accused Jews that they actually are supporting their enemies. And in this setting, no matter how morbid it is, I want to have some truth in those rumors, but also I would like to make basically two kind of Jews. The Jews from the Switzerland, or basically from the West collectively, and the Jews from Russia, or at least the area where this happens, Russia, Poland, these areas. If you know what, did I make this now more understandable?
Yeah, I think I have their understanding.
Okay, I would like to remind Luke to post his question, something like in the chat. Meaning something, did the war, World War I, how did it go, or something like that. And anyway, this is my question, is basically about interest of the Jews abroad and interest of the Jews in Russia, and the idea is to have them in some important aspect actually opposite or different interests, something like that.
I pass on this question.
Okay.
I will actually spend my other jump in for this one. My idea forward is that there's, now that there's a bigger, stronger influence of Judaism in Russia, and they have more magic and that kind of thing, they have more power in that area, Western Jews are considering moving in great numbers to Russia, so it becomes more of a safe haven for Jews who are considered hated or targeted.
So basically, you want Western Jews, they want to create some sort of Israel in Russia, right?
Yeah,
Okay, and what do want Russian Jews? Because the question was, where those two interests differ? So I need you to give me one important difference between interest of local Jews and foreign Jews.
I will. How? Because Western Jews are more. They live in societies where there are more other religions and they're not considered as like superstitions. They're more open to other religions, while the ones that are in Russia are more, don't want to deal with them, don't want to.
Okay, so Western Jews are reconciliatory or something like that. They like reconciling with other religions, while the Russian Jews are purists.
Yeah.
I like it. It can work. And so, and basically, okay, so we have two important things about Jews. That they want to create a safe haven in Russia, and Western ones are more liberal, while local ones are conservative and purists. Okay. I will now pause. I need to pause this question. Excuse me. Okay, Luke, I would like you to ask your next question and type in the important facts from your previous answer, please.
My question is essentially, how big of an influence do the other members of the, the inner circle? So, other than Lenin, how big an influence are Stalin and Trotsky on the new communist Russia?
Okay, if my count is right, that means that Luke has spent his bullet points. Am I right?
Indeed.
Okay. And leaves either me or Flavio with answers.
Yeah. I don't know that much about that point, so I'm going to pass on this one.
Okay, I'm going to answer this one. And I'm going to put it like this. It's the most well-kept secret of the Bolsheviks, but I want to establish the fact that by the end of the campaign, hopefully, I will establish one thing. There will be an open warfare between at least two of the three of them. So basically, there will be eventually a war within Bolshevik, open warfare between, I'm not really sure, who against whom for the time being, nor is it too important, but I will establish that they will be pretty important which character supports which of the Bolshevik leaders. So basically it's Lenin, Stalin or Trotsky. Each of them have their own different personalities, goals, and stuff like that. And also, look, I would like you to mention, you did mention, that Jews want to create safe haven. I'm cool with that. Okay. So, Luke, would you like to type your question so I can type in my answer?
Yep, I'm typing it up now.
Okay. Flavio.
Yeah.
Since you will be answering this next question, there's some kind of topic that you would like this question to be about.
Technology mostly.
Oh yeah. I have the idea. I have a very good idea for this. I was actually planning on this, but I forgot on that. But I'm not gonna ask it until Luke types in his question. Okay. So, here's the question. How much do you suspect that the Polish are listening to your communications? So I'm not asking you whether Polish are listening to your communication. I'm asking how much your character in particular suspects that Polish are listening to his communication, or rather Bolshevik communications.
Well, to put it in perspective, it's not so much as my character thinks that they're listening to him in particular. They're listening to everyone in the army, because that's how spying works.
Okay, but so he suspects that Polish are listening to everyone on the Bolshevik side.
Yeah, because that's how spying works.
Okay, I can work with that. I will type in my answer and my question, and then you can think of something you would like to ask me.
Okay. Okay. I see the answer.
Okay, Flavio.
Okay. And, they are
1, 2, 10. You are free to revisit something which was mentioned, but not.
Okay. And my final question. So, how do the monsters in the countryside affect the day-to-day lives of the inhabitants of Russia and or the war itself?
Oh, I like it. I forgot about the monsters, and they are actually depicted in the illustration, and I like it. We totally forgot about them. Well, one important thing is that they severely depopulated countryside, but more than just depopulating countryside, they were not strictly by attacking humans, but by spoiling harvest and all sorts of stuff like that. So it's not just that monsters occasionally attack humans, as bad as it is, but they also occasionally destroy everything which is built by humans. I mean, it's not still it's almost to the point that governments, or at least not governments, but sites in the conflict, some of them are being forced to unite, not really to fight off the Reds or the Whites with the German expeditionary force, but just to keep the land habitable.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I will not specify which monsters are there. We will leave this for the first story, but there will be definitely some sort of monsters who are somehow spawning or something like that. Anyway, again, I'm gonna type this. And two of you may think about a bit about your aspects and trouble and stuff like that.
I gotta add to my high concept a little bit. So my high concept now, as I have written down, is Bolshevik Cossack, American Turncoat. The idea being that he was with the White Russians, and he turncoat and became a Red.
Okay. You wanna detail how and why he ended up in Russia in the first place.
Oh, how he ended up there joint fighting?
Yeah, because you mentioned he's an American. So I presume he was born in America. A bit family history, that sort of thing.
His original idea was he originally lived in the West, the American West. And so growing up in the heat and all that stuff, eventually it gets really tiring. He started out as a cattle rancher, and then the government took his land so that other people could live on it. And so he became an outlaw. And as kind of a punishment thing, it's like, oh, we're going to send you off, fight in a war with the white Russians, with the Japanese and all that, and we're going, you know. And so not really feeling all that really connected to the people he's in, fighting against an enemy he really doesn't know, he turncoats at an opportunity to do so. We've kind of taken prisoner of war and then switches sides, seeing as there's this inner conflict in Russian, like, hey, they want freedom too, I want freedom too.
Okay, that works for me.
I also have his trouble as well. I like writing my troubles as little phrases. So his trouble is, these reds make an addictive spirit. So he get introduced to vodka, and he got addicted to vodka.
Okay, so you mean spirit as in alcoholic drink, or do you want to keep the term spirit to mean Buddha morale and everything else?
A little of both. Kind of like that he...
Okay. Works very well, because Bolsheviks were really good in propaganda. And that's very nice.
My trouble would be curiosity. So, basically, he'd be like, what's that over there? I need to check it out. What's that over there? I need to check it out.
Okay, how you wanna word it? I mean, Fate Core really likes poetic aspects. So, well, trouble can be... Yeah, I know, but it can be worded like, what's that over there? It will be.
Yeah, it's literally just, I need to check it out.
Yeah, and also basically meaning he leaves his mech unpiloted and goes to check it on foot, right?
Nope. That doesn't mean that I'm leaving anything behind. I'm literally just moving everything that I've got and checking it out.
Yeah, but... there are the times when what... Okay, it works. But I will have you occasionally leave the mech.
Yes, that's true. I will leave the mech from time to time, but not everything will be just I pop out of the mech to check it out.
Okay, but I do want you to think of about, how do I put it, nasty situations when he actually leaves the mech. And you know, that's where the fate points come.
Okay, so let me think of an aspect.
What's that over there works perfectly. Maybe you want something different, but that's good enough for me. I mean...
Okay, so now I'm thinking of aspects. Oddly enough, trouble is easy, aspects are hard.
Not necessarily. I mean, one thing that works for me is that I think of the second trouble, and I write it there, and then I then know for sure I will have enough fate points for all the magic stuff and all the cool things I like to do all the time, like shoot really big guns from my mech or something. Of course, I'm a bit of, how do I say? Projecting myself to your character concept. Also, one other thing which just occurred to me. Yeah. You may want to think and to either write me secretly or make it official. Which one of the three Soviet Bolshevik leaders you like best? So who are you supported? Lenin, Stalin, or Trotsky? And so that I can keep it in mind while designing and playing the opposition.
Okay. I just need to know how they are different so that I know.
We know basically three things. From history, Lenin got syphilis, and he is considered more or less the middle ground between them. He is not necessarily seen as a villain in the West. We know Stalin is most evil and will become evil and violent and everything like that. So I'm thinking of playing Lenin as a bit of ladies' man, Stalin as a bit of, how should I say? Gregor Clegane from Game of Thrones, meaning excessively violent, and of course he will turn eventually evil. I'm not sure if he will win, but he will turn eventually evil. Of course, your character needs not know that, and also your character need not be the good guys. For Trotsky, he is generally romanticized in the West as the most noble and most benevolent of the three, and that's why he was defeated, because basically he was too good for his own good. But I'm not really sure how I'm gonna play Trotsky in the terms of personality, but I'm gonna make him more intellectual and more idealistic than either Lenin or Stalin, if that helps you a bit.
Yes, that helps me a lot. So basically I'm going with Lenin.
Okay. Luke, do you want to tell publicly who your character likes, or do you want to send it in private message over the Facebook one? Well, no, I'm changing.
I don't mind making it public.
Say it publicly, but we will keep that strictly player knowledge, not character knowledge.
Alright, he's gonna, I think he'd be more towards Lenin.
Okay, so you are both Leninists. That's a good thing. You may wanna think about spending one aspect on either why you are supporting Lenin or something regarding that particular faction within the Bolshevik movement. Like, I met Lenin once or something like that, or I drank Lenin under the table. Just jokes, but something like that, or something like history will remember Leninism as the only true communism that has ever existed, or something like.
Although I'm going to make a different joke, because based on what you said. So my first aspect would be my boss is a ladies' man.
Okay. That works perfectly. Do you want this to refer exactly personally to Lenin, or do you want me to think of your boss?
This is more like in general when you're thinking of Leninism. Yeah, my boss is a ladies' man.
Okay.
This is not referring to, I'm going to flat out say he's Lenin, it's just that my boss is a lady.
Okay, excellent. I like the idea. This actually gives me one more NPC whose personality I can think of and add a few aspects of my own. That works perfectly.
Mm-hmm.
And also, yes, I almost forgot from all this politics and stuff like that. There is the red-haired comrade girl.
Oh, yeah.
And you know, I mean, she will be present at one form or the other. I'll write her explicitly in the story, well, hopefully a bit later, but you may wanna include her in your aspects if you have trouble thinking of interesting aspects.
Oh no, it is in my first aspect.
Oh, it is. Then please share it. I mean,
oh, I just said my boss is a ladies' man.
Oh, okay. But either of you may actually write her in personally. I mean, like, you know, you would like to be with her, or that you were former lovers or something like that.
Oh, she's the former lover of my boss, not mine.
Unless you spend an aspect on this, I will keep it as a rumor.
Yes, it is rumor. I don't know for sure in character. This is just a rumor. Anyway.
So my first aspect is a little controversial, I suppose. Mine is first Marx, now Lenin, then me.
I love it. No problem. Excellent idea. You want politically ambitious American who wants to lead Russia. I love it. I love it. Cool. Yeah. I like it very, very much. I mean, with such an ambitious character, all the work that we actually put in the politics of the setting certainly won't go to waste.
My second aspect would be I love working on my mech.
Ha ha ha. Okay, I love my mech.
Yeah, I love working on my mech.
Okay, works for me. Works for me. Okay, give me a second. I think I have prepared, actually not I think, I have prepared, Roll 20 campaign for this. Only most basic. Stuff, but I do have hopefully character sheets we can use, and also I would rather use the map as tracker for fate points than to use chat log or something like that. I think if you, at least if you know how to handle roll 20, you should be able to open character sheets from your characters. If not, we'll use the Fate Roller app, which is not my favorite, but you'll have it. But I know it better than Roll 20. So you should open the Roll 20 app and see if you can start filling the character sheets there. And hopefully I'll in the meantime find a way to see your character sheets when I need to, rather than keep a local copy at my computer. If not, we'll use Fate Roller. But let's try with Roll 20 first. And also, I will give another, let's say, midpoint break, because we spent like, well, not full 2 hours. We spend 1 hour and 40 minutes. So we'll give it a 5 minutes break and to give you time to try to figure out character sheets. I'm sorry, this is just my second time I'm running Fate Online, so I'm not don't know exactly how everything works on Roll20, but if it proves to be too complicated, we'll switch to the Fate Roller.
Anyway. I really don't know how to do this.
Try to figure out for about few minutes on your own, and then we'll see in about 5 minutes time. And if we spend more than 10 minutes on it, we will go back to the Fate Roller, which I know well enough. Okay?
Okay.
Okay, folks, I'm back. Okay, so you made a bit of rolling, but I made it explicitly that this was a Fate Core game, which is...
I'm testing out to see how this works, and I'm like looking for the clutch dice, but I can't see them.
Okay, has either of you been able to open character sheet?
No.
Okay, now give me about a minute to Google it up, and if we can't Google it, we will use roll 20. I don't know for what, but maybe just to type on it some stuff that we can't use Fate Roller for. Or otherwise, we'll just ditch it. I don't know. Just give me a second. This won't last more than a minute or two. Okay, I found something. Give me a second. Okay, guys. Here's the thing. You have in Roll 20 app. You have top right corner. You have six icons. First one is the chat. Second one is the library. Third one is journal. You should have, when you click on that icon, you should be able to open character sheet from there.
What library? Because I don't have that library icon. It just skips to journal.
Yeah, click on the journal.
It's empty.
And it has nothing in it.
Yes.
Okay, just a second. Okay, now I do have. I know what I need to do. You guys picked names for your characters, because I need apparently to create a character for you. So give me a name, and that would be, and you should be able to create the character. So I need to give you the character. So actually,
yeah. Well, I thought of a nickname for him rather than an actual name.
Okay.
I'll type it in the chat.
Okay, Chelu. Okay. So.
Yeah, because Chelu is actually Baldy.
Okay, Chela. I understand it enough.
Yeah.
Osmanli. It's Turkish for head.
Yeah. Well, the nickname that I'm thinking for him is basically Kelu, which is Baldy, for the simple fact that he's bald, and everyone when he was at school was like, hey, hey, look at the Baldy.
Okay. Character sheet. Now, I think by now you should have your character sheet. Look, I need your name, and I'm gonna create a character character for you.
Name-wise, it's an American name.
Okay.
Jeremiah.
Jeremiah, okay.
And,
With age or without age?
With age.
Okay. Well, actually, I don't need anything more. Jeremia in Russian, if it matters to you.
Hmm?
Jeremia in Russian. That is Jeremiah. If it matters. Okay, at least I think it is. It is in Serbian like that. Only visible to GM, damn it. Okay, guys, you should be able to start filling your character sheets by now, and you should be able to roll from this sheet. If we cannot roll from this sheet, we will use Fate Roller. But at least we have a functioning character sheet where we can add consequences, remove consequences, write in, check the stress and stuff like that. Okay, so I can see that now you're able to fill. I will repeat the skill list in the chat. So you can pick skills that you need. Basically, I've merged athletics with physique. DC with provoke. I have a few new ones like empathy, influence. Languages is something that will be useful to both of you because it's Eastern Europe. People don't learn foreign languages much. I may rethink that. If it proves
well,
a problem.
To be fair, some of them do, some of them don't. Romania, the Romanian territory has a long history of knowing at least one or two foreign languages because of the whole being under the various influences of the various empires, so they know Romanian plus another language, or plus two in the case of Transylvania.
Yeah. Well, okay, anyway, I thought that adding languages skill would be pretty cool.
No worries, I'm going to put everywhere that I think it's okay, first I need this.
And also another thing is you may leave you may leave space open in your in your character sheet. So okay, I can see you are well enough in the terms of stats, in the terms of aspects. One other thing I'm going to do is that, Cello will be able to use his own stunts to add stunts either for him or for his mech.
Uh-huh.
And to balance this, Jeremiah, I'm gonna give you a unit of soldiers, and you will be able to spend your stunts on making your unit more powerful. Does that sound workable?
Indeed it does.
Okay, so basically, that's gonna be it. I'm not going to charge you explicitly for the size of the unit or the size of your mech, but I will charge you with adding cool features to either the unit or the mech. I don't have any list. Okay, but I'm kind of thinking this is Fate Core and we'll improvise it something along the way.
Question, what does Rapport do?
Rapport, it's basically people liking you, or as it is defined more precisely, maintaining long-term friendships. So basically it means that it's, you are trusted and well-liked by other people. One of my favorite skills to put at the plus four, because it enables me to break any rules, because everyone likes me. I did it at least one occasion. Difference between alertness and notice is that alertness is passive when someone is trying to sneak up on you, and stuff like sixth sense and that sort of thing, while notice is more closely with searching stuff. Leadership includes all military thinking, such as not just commanding your people, but being able to understanding strategy, understanding mission parameters, and stuff like that. Basically knowing, it determines how good a soldier your character is.
Mm-hmm. Okay, so then wilderness, what does that do?
Wilderness. Come on, I mean, it's surviving in the wilderness, navigation, stuff like that. I mean, Munye means it's plural from Munya. Munya is individual lightning bolt, flash of light. At least in Serbian, I'm not sure about Russian.
Anyway, I think I have put in all of the skills that I think he'll need.
Okay, well, you don't need to fill everything up for it, but okay. You may want to push willpower up or down, because at plus two, willpower gives you exactly the same number of stress as if it was at will one, and it is rolled relatively seldom, as long as you might want to switch willpower to shoot. That's my... or languages or something like that.
Okay, sure. And I'm going to put physics there at one.
Okay.
Okay. So okay. I think it's good.
Yeah, it's looks good to me. Alertness, report, notice, shoot, looks good to me. But of course, you can leave some stuff up, out. I'm sorry. And
yeah, anyway, so now I have to think of my stunts.
Also, one other thing.
Mm.
I'm not too much a fan of stunts, and I'm proposing this. Maybe you want to use all of your stunts to your Mac and to your unit. I mean, if we were to play like common mortals or common humans without any stunts, I'd be perfectly happy.
Yeah, that's all right. I was thinking of just making stunts that are oriented to my mech in one way or another.
Okay. That's of course proposal. Some things like being a sniper or something like that. Some
no.
sort of. No, I didn't mean to you. I mean to.
Okay.
Maybe Jeremiah or something like that would work well as a stunt, but basically I'm thinking that you should be spending stunts primary to make your, let's say, secondary character, because your mech and your unit will definitely be characters, and they will be able to occasionally perform actions even without you, so it can work to sort of like you know, pimp your mech and pimp your unit. Also, a quick question. I'm not making any promises, but does anyone want to suggest what the first mission should be about? Do you want basic combat, or you want investigation, or monsters?
Well, the things that I would want is more like I receive a mission from HQ to check out the wilderness to see where or not why the supplies have been growing low, because we need a certain units to be outfitted and they don't have enough supplies, so they need to pass through a certain village and we need to see why that certain village isn't sending supplies.
Okay. So you want basically an investigation mission. Luke?
I think it would make sense that if they wouldn't just send a mech, they'd probably send some, like a ground battalion, a ground unit.
Yeah, of course, you are going together. No question about it. But as far as I'm concerned, you will be having the same commander, same boss, but is there something you would like to see to start up with?
I don't mind a first mission being a mix of both, like having a little bit of
both
combat and social.
I beg your pardon?
Both combat and social work.
And social work, did you say that?
Like, no, I'm
sorry,
confusing things. A mix of all of it, kind of.
Okay. I will do it definitely. Oh, Mooney Gromovi. Okay. I can see Serbian language, which makes me happy. okay. Okay. I is lowercase, but doesn't matter. Lightning led by thunder. Basically, translation is lightning and thunder. If it really matters. But okay. I like it, definitely. I like it. I'm not really sure how you gonna invoke
essentially,
it.
Essentially, it's that the first thing you see the lightning first, and then you hear the thunder. So it and this is gonna be opposite. So it's like
okay, I understand.
You'll hear the thunder before you see the lightning. Now it's gonna.
Okay, I understand it. This is a fair warning. I'm not too sure I understand well enough the last two aspects, which means that you will have to put additional effort to suggest compels and invocations than normally.
Okay. Be more specific.
You don't need to be specific beforehand, but you will have to keep a better eye on things that go on and spend a bit more during the play explaining to me how it is relevant until I get the full grasp of your aspect, if you understand me.
Mm-hmm.
Because I really take the effort to memorize and keep in mind as many aspects from all of my characters as I humanly can, and when there is an aspect I'm not too I don't understand well enough, it can make it there is a danger of it being underused, if you understand me.
Mm-hmm.
Of course, this is both responsibility of player and GM, but as someone who is rather experienced, I'm not sure what your experiences are, but as someone who is rather experienced, I've noticed this in games.
Oddly enough, in each game of Fate that I've played so far, I kind of use them all, even the stunts and all of the aspects and the skills at least once. So.
Okay.
I don't know why.
Yeah, well, it's a good thing. It's just that whenever. I mean, just that in my own games, it turned out that I felt it, that fewer the aspects about character I can keep in my head, it means that this character grows in real danger of being sidelined, if you know what I mean.
Well, sometimes it doesn't have to be the central focus, and others it will be, but that depends on how the situation changes, depending on what happens, you know? I don't know beforehand how the situation will unfold, because if I did, then why am I playing this game.
Yeah, I know. I'm just saying something that I've noticed in my games as a warning.
Sure. It's fine.
Something to keep an eye on. Loud is thunder, deadly is lightning. I like it that I can compel and invoke much more easily. Okay. So, mission briefing. Okay, guys. Oh yes, I didn't explain one other thing, which is very useful. Okay, when you open the Roll20 app, you will see some blue, white, and red circles.
Uh-huh.
Basically, these will be fate point trackers. Something like that. I'm gonna use the white ones as fate points and the blue ones as boosts. Red ones is something I've invented, which is, let's put it this way, threats. So if you succeed at cost or something like that, or you do something which I not really dislike, but I think it's dangerous, I will give you red token. Basically, red tokens means how much of threat level I should apply to your character. And you want to get rid of them. Basically meaning that if you compel yourself or you want something smaller than compel, but if you want to attract a lot of monsters to attack you, then you can say, okay, give me 3 red tokens worth of monsters, and then I will narrate from that point. Basically, as you go in combat and take risky actions and overcome the risks, I will take away your red tokens you may have, and that's generally a good thing. Think of them something like kind of consequence. I prefer to use red tokens rather than fate points that I have for boosts and everything else that enemies do. So, for instance, I'd rather have you say, okay, use one of your red tokens to have a monster cast his spell or something other dangerous, do something dangerous, than to arbitrarily spend a fate point. Think of them as opposite of boosts. Also, in case of you are unfamiliar with fate accelerated, boosts are like fate points, but only related to either one scene or one game aspect or one skill of yours basically meaning if they are not spent, they disappear after a while. Meaning, you can use them instead of fate points under some circumstances. Basically, if you succeeded with style on one stealth action, for instance, you can use boost to alter the scene, for instance, who you snuck up on or what they're doing, for instance. If you successfully succeed with style on sneaking up on some white Russians, you may alter the scene and say, oh, they have a piece of technology that we need, or something like that. Anyway, this is how it works. Let me check out again character sheets. Okay, so I like both of yours. I'm thinking electromagnetic because it will be quite nasty, will require a fate point to activate.
Oh yeah, it is a stunt basically, so.
Yeah, but it's powerful stunt because it hits the entire zone. I mean, zone as in mech zone as opposed to human zone. Yeah, I mean, it's on the huge scale.
Okay, I've put it in parentheses that it costs one fate point.
Okay.
Anyway.
That's the... as far as down like the bullet, I'm not gonna put any activation on it up front, but I'll see how it works later. Okay. Perhaps it lasts for a number of rounds equal to your science or something like that. Basically meaning that during that time you can, your mech can run very fast, and then it cannot run for a while. I'm not sure for how long, but we'll think of something. Anyway, I like this. Okay, Jeremiah, no stunts yet. Jeremiah, I mean, look, have you decided on how big you want your unit to be?
I'm not entirely sure,
Give me a general idea. Do you want 30 men or 100 men or 1,000 men?
Probably 30.
Okay. We'll call it squadron. I'll have to do the Google Translate to translate from Serbian because I'm not that versed with military units. Just give me a sec. Okay, I'm not gonna Google American unit size, but I'm gonna call it squadron. and if it matters, you want to give the name of the squadron? Okay, I'm gonna offer you Spartacus as a name. Or rather, Spartak, as Russians call it. Okay. We're gonna call that a nickname. You may invent a designation, army and stuff like that if you have time.
But put that under stunts or extras?
I'll put descriptions under extras and mechanics under stunt. So for instance, if you want to make your squadron more disciplined or something like that, put it at stunts like +2 when discipline matters, while on extras you may describe how you keep them disciplined, so stuff like that. Keep the narrative part under extras and mechanical part under stunts, if at all possible.
Okay.
That's all I care. Anyway, is it infantry or cavalry? Are they all Cossacks like yourself, or just you?
I was kind of hoping they're all also Cossacks.
Okay, works for me. Works for me, cavalry squadron. It's not as good as you think, because basically hitting a horse is easier than hitting a human being. So you will be more mobile than infantry, but also more vulnerable to shooting, if you understand what I mean.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. Okay, as far as I'm concerned, we're set to go. I'm not gonna specify still what point in time we are playing as of yet. It may change along the way, but for the time being, I'm gonna frame the scene in the following way. Your commander is giving you the orders to actually go back from your front position on Polish front, because there are some communication problems, and he has already dispatched Liliana. I'm gonna call her Liliana. I know you will have problem. Luke might have problem pronouncing it, but it's Lily. And it means Lily, and we're gonna make our red-haired girl, named Lily, Liliana, and he has already sent her to investigate, but she hasn't come back yet. That doesn't necessarily mean anything much, but you should check it out too. I mean, if she hasn't returned, it might mean that she may need help. And also one other thing which is important about her, she's a bit proud. So she may be hesitant to actually ask for help. So you will go there to check if she needs help. Anyway, this is basically it in terms of mission, in terms of important stuff I have planned so far. But if either of you wants to actually role play the meeting, I'm all for it. Or if you want to go straight to the mission, we can do that too.
Okay, so one thing that I'm a bit unclear is how do I actually roll?
Oh yeah. For rolling, we will use entirely different app. That is Fate Roller.
Oh, okay. I found it.
Yeah, and basically on the second tab, you I tell you to roll. For instance, plus 2, and it rolls for you.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
Basically, there are other cool stuff, like next one lets you alter the color of your dice. So, for instance, to easily distinguish between characters who rolled what. Most of the other stuff we won't use, except maybe you want to check display result overlay, because if I'm not mistaken, yes, that means that when I roll the dice, they will appear on my video feed. So basically, everyone else here, if they're looking close enough, they'll be able to see it. Anyway, since Luke went for the second, I'm gonna pause game for a bit. Luke, are you back?
No, I'm just leaving now.
Okay. I'm gonna go and grab a drink for myself, and we'll continue in 5 minutes.
Yeah, I'll go and grab something myself as well.
Okay.
I've returned.
Okay, I'm back also. I guess we're waiting for Flavio.
Question. When you mentioned there were the tokens, where do they actually show up?
Oh, yes. I forget to explain it. When you open a Roll20 app,
mm-hmm.
you have a top three white circles, and one is your fate points, the other is Flavius, and basically you click on the black arrow, which should enable you to select and move, and then you click on the one of the circles, and you can delete it when you spend a fate point, or copy, so you have it in your clipboard, and then later as you gain a fate point, you may right-click at the empty space and do paste. And this is the way it's easiest for me to keep track of fate points. It's not...
I can't even select it.
I beg your pardon?
I can't select the circle. I can't.
Oh, okay. Just a second. Looks like I need to enable you to do that. And since I don't have time to research it, I'm gonna do it for you. So I'm gonna... I'm sorry. I was explaining to Luke that we will be using Roll20 in addition for character sheets only for tracking fate points. So, meaning, let's say that top circles are Luke's fate points and lower circles are Flavius fate points, and since I don't think you can edit them, I'll need to research how to enable players to edit this grid, but for the time being I will do it for you. So for instance, when you spend a fate point, I will be raising it, and when you gain a boost or a threat, I will give you 1 point instead. I hope it works. I mean, I really don't plan on using any sort of map or anything like that. This is Fate Core. I mean, the zones are intentionally intended to be vague. So anyway,
cool. Let's do this.
Okay. So Lily was sent to investigate. She hasn't reported yet, but it's not real cause for alarm, but your boss wants to check up on her. Of course, if you wanna role play the meeting with him, we can do that, or instead we can go straight to the village.
Usually I'd just have a few words with my boss and then go to the village.
Okay. So. Is there something you want to have in private, or...?
it's... I could go either or, you know?
Okay, well, okay, so... Trevor, what's up?
Hey, boss. I just finished working on a new module on my mech. It lets me to make an EMP for at least, I think it's 25 meters, although I need to actually put it to the test to see how much it actually gets.
You wanna do what? Okay, your boss does not understand robots or stuff like that.
It's more like shoot lightning out of the robot and disable other mechs in doing so.
And it works?
It works. I just need to test it to see what's the range of it. I don't know how many mechs would be caught into the fire.
And you want to test it on our mechs?
Now, if you have any job for me that I would investigate to see if the whites have anything against us, you know?
Well, look. The nearest reserve with damaged mechs are on the other side of the village, all the way in Kursk, and if everything is okay in the village, drop by at Kursk and see if locals have some robots for you to experiment.
Well, the boss.
Okay. Anything else?
Nothing much. I'm just curious of one thing. There was this comrade of ours that went a while ago. I'm not sure if she should have reported back yet or not.
Well, if she found something, as she usually does, she wouldn't report. If everything went easily, she would be back. It's not much of a problem, but you know her. You know women, they always have something to prove, that they can do our job as well as we do. I mean, we all know it's not true. And, go just check up on her. I mean, just do it, I mean... And you said you wanted to test your, how do you call it?
EMP for short.
Yeah, amp, Well, test your amp over there if you want to, but, you know, I mean, killing two birds with one stone, you know.
I know, boss, I know. I'll see you later, then.
Okay. Yeremia. Look.
Yep, I'm there.
Yeah, well, get used to answering when I call you Yeremia. You know, so, you have something or you're ready to ride?
I'm ready to ride.
Okay. So, I'm gonna make, because of, it sounds right for the setting, that the horses are actually faster than the mech. No, I mean, and they tire and all sort of thing, but they're generally faster than mech. So, if for whatever reason, Luke, you wanna go ahead, you can enter the village first, or you can go the same speed, however you like.
Do we have, like, can I communicate through him with the radio system, or?
Basically, no, you don't have portable communication on horseback. Basically, in order to communicate with Chela, you will have to, how do I put it, ride up to his leg and pick up the telephone and speak to him through that. That is, unless you wanna spend one stunt of some telecommunication equipment.
Or you could just go to the village and go to the nearest phone station, kind of like
that. Yeah, well, nearest phone station is in Kursk. This is Russia, 1920.
Yeah, exactly. So,
you know, you'd be lucky if they have telegram. And you'd be even luckier if it works with all the monsters around.
Exactly.
It's not that simple. Basically, you have problem still communicating with one another.
In that case,
you can send someone to deliver a message. So you basically do have couriers, and Chela may just, you know, bang or shoot or something like that. You'll probably hear him from distance, but you won't be able to easily communicate, if you understand what I'm talking about.
Yep. I understand.
Okay.
So, Jeremiah will go to the village.
Okay, so you will ride first. Or no?
Yeah. I'll try and speed ahead to try and...
Okay. Let's have, make a notice at all.
I don't actually have it as a written down skill, so it's
damn
a
zero. It's the zero. You sure you don't want to put it somewhere? Not really.
Nah, he's more focused on strategy and being a loudmouth more than...
Hey, wrong wilderness.
Oh, wilderness? Oh,
marginally better. Okay.
That was...
Yeah,
noticed.
No, one. Total of one. Because you have,
Yeah, they cancel out. Okay, so, what happens?
Here's the thing, you're not able to notice anything much, except, you notice that there have been a lot of tracks. You cannot identify them nor do some really important tracking, but you do notice a lot of tracks. Basically, if you want to succeed at cost in investigation, I'll give you additional information, or I can keep it this much.
Hmm. I think I'll go with just the information I have rather than looking into it more.
Okay. Okay. Going back to cello. Okay, we'll put it this way. Jeremiah, you reached the village without any major incident. So far, I'm gonna have Chalu do the same role. Notice, okay. Please.
Yeah. Okay, so it's plus three. One. Wow. Okay. So I have one. Cause yeah.
Oh, you you have okay, only one. If you wanna spend fate point to reroll it or go with the same information.
I'm going with the same information because this is just mildly interesting.
Okay.
Him.
Okay. So, okay. Going back to the village, Jeremiah, notice, villages are not are in their houses, and nobody's really going out to greet you. And it's like people have for some reason withdrawn to their houses, and here's one other thing, which is readily obvious. The local tavern is empty. Like there are no one at the tavern. Not all no one at the tavern. Tavern is technically open, but there are no guests.
So,
which
Jeremiah
is kind of strange because in Russia you'll always have someone drinking.
Jeremiah and his squad will kind of move into the where the tavern is, and he'll get off of horseback, dismount, and make his way into the tavern, and seeing that there's nobody there.
Well, there's actually a bartender whose job is to work at the tavern. He's there, but there's nobody else.
In a very, like, loud voice, he'll look at the bartender and say, "Where is everyone?"
At home, I suppose?
That does not make very much sense.
Yeah, well, you people need to decide. Do you want people drinking or do you don't want people drinking? I mean, you know how folks are afraid of the new regime. And you people being angry.
Jeremiah will kind of lean slightly over the bar and carefully point at this guy and say, "Be careful what you say about the new regime, comrade."
Yeah, well, the new regime seems to be doing everything to put me out of business, and so far they're succeeding. They want people to be healthy, to be well, to be obedient, and they don't want them to drink alcohol. So what should they do when they come to the tavern? Oh, yes. Mm. And you banned all the hookers also. We hear good people. We don't make no troubles. Everything is as should. People at home. It's Wednesday. No one goes to church. No one goes to tavern. No problem.
Hmm. So does that mean there's no alcohol in the bar at all?
Well, there is. The allowed amount of alcohol. There is a allowed amount. Basically, they have a quota.
Ah.
And he has his quota available. Does the revolution have the money for the alcohol? Or will you requisition it as for the war?
Jeremiah will look behind him at his squad who are outside, and then he'll look back at the bartender and say, think of it this way. It is both a war requisition, and me not telling my commanders that I have a white hiding amongst the red.
You have a white among you?
I'm looking at him.
You don't have a right among you, comrade. You just have to say it, that you are requisitioning it. I'm doing everything as you people say. And I'm doing everything for the revolution. You already drafted two of my sons. And he starts giving you the bottles.
I have my men come on, bring in and take a bottle each, and well, there's probably not enough for them all, but
you don't have enough to give them each a bottle. I mean, you have like one bottle for five of them, and it's vodka, so it's not that weak.
In that case, Jeremiah will take two bottles and then tell his men to divide amongst themselves and enjoy the rest.
Okay. And, well, basically, the tavern owner gives you personally, behind your back, not your back, behind the back of your man, a half a bottle for yourself. Take this. This is, we have leftovers. I don't need it. You might want to use it, Commander.
Thank you.
As I said, I don't want no trouble. Everything is fine here. Wanna roll a rapport?
Sure. Rapport is 3.
I noticed.
I get a 1.
Okay.
I'd like to spend a fee point to reroll that up again.
Okay.
Give it two.
Okay, that's enough. And here's the thing. Perhaps you should ask him about a single woman on horseback who may have rode through here a couple of days ago. I mean, it's not too many women are in your ranks, and it's 1918, so it's still unusual for the woman to go out on her own. Beautiful woman, you can't expect him to have missed her.
So yeah, I ask him about if he's seen a woman, a red-haired woman riding through the village.
Yeah, should have known she's yours. Well, she gave us explicit instructions, and we followed them to the letter. She told us not to think. Just do as she says. And I've done that.
And what did she say?
To stay at home, gather all the garlic we have, and distribute two of the... How do they call it? How do you call individual garlic?
Garlic. It's just garlic. It's one garlic, yeah. Two garlic.
Okay, to give two garlics to each house, and stay at home till you people arrived. And we did that.
Garlic.
And now that he mentions it, you see two garlics hanging behind the bar.
Did you say why garlic?
Do your people ever tell why?
Good point.
And we did that. She didn't say how long to stay at home, but I'm guessing you people know. And will tell us when we can resume planting the corn for the next year, which you will dutifully come to requisition for the war. Of course, I need not tell you why, in theory, she could do such a thing, but
I don't know. It's like separation of character knowledge and player knowledge.
Of course, you know the stories. And of course, you are not allowed to admit that they may be truth in it, but you do know that werewolves avoid the smell of garlic. I mean, of course, these are just fairy tales, and, you know, the only thing, the only real effective thing that keeps werewolves and other monsters away is unity of the people who are willing to fight and defend their villages, led by the benevolent Communist Party. You know how it works.
Mm-hmm. And since my guy has seen it from both sides, like, as a white and as a red, the spirit of the Communist Party.
Yeah, well, whites would have a priest bless every house, and they would have the priest carry the nearest miraculous icon around the village in a religious procession, and it would be probably as effective as garlic.
In that case, Jeremiah kind of quickly stands up. Question, because I have no idea. What's a proper way to say goodbye to somebody?
You just nod. Okay. Head on. Or something like, go on, comrade, or something like that.
Okay. So, essentially do that. I nod and say, good luck, comrade. And may your sons reach generals.
Okay, roll leadership.
Alright, well, that's luckily my highest stat.
Yeah, I know, that's about time to start actually using it. So.
Five.
Okay. So, basically, it's with style. Well, to begin with a few details, which I'll let you up on the front. First thing is, it's perfectly like Lily to go on and handle the werewolf infestation on her own rather than calling for backup. And the fact that they might kill her, well, she is not too concerned about that, if you understand me.
Mm-hmm.
Second, and this is more important, take a boost. Or rather, I'll give you a boost, and your responsibility is to remember that this one is related. Okay, I'm having. Okay, something has happened to my roll 20 app, and I don't know what is going on. Just give me a second. Okay. He's behaving strangely. Anyway, basically, it means that if you have one boost, which is related to Liliana, and if you need something, you can spend it instead of fate point as long as it's related to her.
Okay.
She's on the mission, and now you at least have some idea what you're dealing with. And she's kind of like thrill seeker. You know, which is in theory a good thing, but you know the drill. Anyway, what more do you want before the Chelal arrives?
Mostly it's relaying what I heard from him to my soldiers, essentially.
Okay. How much do you want really to tell them? I mean, you don't really want to think them that they're going to be fighting werewolves. I mean,
no, essentially I tell them that Lily was tasked by the great Communist Party to defeat an enemy of quote unknown origin.
Okay.
Who has been terrorizing the villagers. And okay. We are to kind of defend this village should those enemy make their way here.
Okay. Fine. And of course you brought vodka, so this made them less nervous than it would otherwise. Okay. Meanwhile, okay, Chela.
Yeah.
How big is your robot? I mean, is it so loud that it will big and loud that it will crowd the street, or it is something smaller?
Well, it's not so much as it will crowd the whole street, more like half of it. But you definitely hear it coming.
Okay.
It has a good suspension that it won't shake everything in its path, but you definitely hear it from, I don't know,
a distance, I understand.
Okay. Small distance, not a large one, but a small one.
Okay. So it's not really built for sneaking. I understand.
It's not so much as sneaking. It's more like it has weapons. It can run fast if need be, but it's not that big that it will destroy the whole village just by being there.
Okay, I understand. I understand. About the size of modern tank, I guess.
More or less, yes.
Okay. Since Luke has around 20 minutes left, and we've been playing what's in 7, okay, I will do a bit of role playing, and we'll go faster. And also one other thing, now that Luke mentioned it, since we will obviously not end this tonight, I propose we continue the same time in a week time.
Sure. Make an event just so that I remember.
Yeah, I'll recycle this event. No problem.
I'm fine with that.
Okay, and we'll see if someone joins then, they will be able to, I don't know, vote their character somehow. Anyway, Chalu, is there anything exactly you want to do?
Well, basically, he'd be going into the village and going straight to the testing grounds so that he can figure out how...
No. It's not going to be that simple. You need to complete the mission and then go to Kursk. You know, I mean...
This is on the way. Okay.
Yeah. I mentioned it's on the other side of the village. Basically meaning you need to complete whatever is in the village. And... Okay.
So he'd be going in the village... And trying to look first from the mech to see what's the situation, to get a better view, and then get the latch out to climb down the stairs to see it on foot, what's up. Because he would be noticing that, everyone's inside their house.
Yeah, well, do you want to roll notice?
Okay, I'm rolling notice. That's a 3. Oop. Okay, so I've got a 2.
Okay, I won't go. You don't roll notice much beyond what I've already explained. Villages... visibly deserted. Jeremiah's soldiers are now setting up roadblocks just to, well, defending positions, and that's more or less about it. And it's not too difficult to guess that he is in the local tavern, which is also not too difficult to find. So basically, you want to park and continue on foot, or you want to call him or whatever you like.
Well, I'd be parking right next to where his as closely to him as possible, so that it would be a short distance from my mech.
No problem. Okay.
Okay. So, hey, Commander, what's the situation? He'd be saying this to Jeremiah, by the way.
I'll look at my my mech friend, and kind of wait. He's outside of the mech.
Yeah, just climbed outside, and he's.
And
going...
also one other thing. Even though Chelu does not. Have any men under his command, he is almost at the same rank as you are. You outrank him only slightly, meaning that the ranks are really based on how powerful is the unit, that is, the mech as opposed to your unit, then it is... it's not based on number of men he has under command. So if you are captain, he is something like lieutenant.
Yeah. So.
Basically, he's basically second in rank in the unit. I mean, he's not technically a part of the unit, but you know, I want to establish this from the start that you are like, you need to treat him much better and much more officially and have more trust in him than in any...
Than my other soldiers.
Yeah.
So, I don't even think I can pronounce your name.
Hello. It's... I know, everyone is more interested in the baldness of my head than my actual name, so I just went with it.
So, Jeremiah kind of comes over and kind of gently leads him a little bit away from the rest of the rest of the soldiers and takes out the bottle of vodka that he was given by the bartender. He opens up, takes a quick swig of it, and kind of pats it against his friend's chest and says, you'll need a drink before I explain.
He takes a swig. Okay.
Werewolves.
Really? That's why she's so late? Okay. At least I need to check if I have enough gas to pour up the flamethrowers, but... Really?
Just a second.
Mm.
Chalu?
Yeah?
You have burned that monster aspect, which basically means you have flamethrowers on your mech. That's not a problem.
Yeah.
And... we'll say that for basic attacks with flamethrower, you don't need to spend fate point. But if you want to throw big fireball, you will need to spend fate point.
Yeah, and he'll be like, luckily for me, I stuck enough fuel. And wow, I never thought that I would be doing this this early in the morning. I would have just been glad with experimenting on my new weapon that I've equipped.
Chalu, let me remind you that you do have Bandit Monster aspect.
Yes, I do.
Do you want a fate point?
I want that fate point.
Okay. Well, you may decide to go around and take a look on your own rather than wait for Jeremiah and his men to prepare.
Well. He'll be like, I need to check it out, because I have that trouble.
Damn yeah, it. And that's true.
He gets on the mech, because I have the aspect burn that monster, and I need to check it out.
Okay, one is enough.
So, yeah, he gets into the mech and starts moving. To check it out.
Okay. Let's see. Chalu. Be nice and roll wilderness and make me happy.
Okay, I'm rolling my wilderness, and that is just the one. Zero.
Lovely, you wanna succeed at cost?
Yes.
Okay. Well, basically, having left Jeremiah and his men to drink and prepare defensive positions and everything like that, you go into wilderness, and you're not too sure exactly where you are, but you do find, well, not exactly werewolves, but you find a wolf lair. And well, that's the first problem, is you're not too sure where you are. The other thing that, in theory, should be able to actually draw werewolves, if there are around, if they are around, is, well, you might want to torch some wolves instead, and they may come up to defend them.
Okay, I'm going to be a dick and start burning.
Okay, there's no much role in. Well, actually, a role shoot.
I'm shooting. Yeah. One. Wow, the
Lovely.
Dice is, keep on hating me tonight.
Yeah, well, it's questionable whether you want to make this roll or not. But let's just say that you set ablaze the wolf lair, and several wolves start running out, and as they start running out, of course, a bit of forest fire catches everything, of course, but there's a silver lining in whole thing. Lirana appears on her horseback. And she says, "What the fuck do you think you're doing?" And actually, she does not bother finding telephone on your leg. She shouts it loud enough that you can hear it from your Mac.
I'm opening the hatch and yelling back, "I'm burning some werewolves."
Hello?
Yeah, I said I'm burning some werewolves.
I'm not sure if you heard / understood what I said. You do manage to burn wolf lair.
Yeah.
And it starts burning, and several wolves do run out, and you're not really sure how much you've achieved that, but there's one other thing that happens. Lilana, the red-haired girl, which was sent to investigate.
Yeah, she appears and yells, "What the fuck am I doing?" And basically, he yells out to her, "I'm burning werewolves."
Yeah.
That's what he wants to do. Even though technically he's burning the wolf lair and not knowing if it's actual werewolves or not.
Okay. Well, cool. She rides off her horse, so angry and stuff like that, and picks up the telephone and she shouts at the at telephone, "I am nuts! I was investigating! Damn, I was gonna find the contra-revolutionary elements that were behind this shit! Now you scared them off! Now we'll never find them!"
What? What revolutionary elements?
They're not just a revolutionary element! Counter-revolutionary elements! Enemies of the state! Enemies of our people! Enemies of the revolution! Do you understand me? You fucking Romanian dick!
These are just mindless beasts, you little bitch!
Don't you speak to me like that! I'm gonna have Boris send you to cleaning duty for next 2 months for speaking to me like this! Again! Listen to me! I found the warlock that got them! I found when they were hiding! And you just fucking scared them away! I was this close to bringing him to Minsk for public trial! And now we will be lucky if we even kill him!
Well, then you should have just reported that to the central station! You haven't...
Why the fuck should I waste my days going back and forth when I can bring him in? And then she stops. And now I'll never fucking bring him back in the handcuffs. Do you idiots know anything other than the brute fucking force? And she slams the telephone back and hangs up.
Bitch. Yeah, that's what he says, bitch.
Yeah, well, okay.
Still. I'm going to roll notice to, or notice was the active one or alertness?
Notice. I mean, you'll need the alertness only if someone is actually hiding.
Okay.
Or you want to create advantage. Okay.
Yeah. I have 2 on a notice check to see.
What exactly do you want to know?
Because I've seen the animals that kept on going outside, but I'd never seen werewolves or warlocks or whatever.
No. Basically, it looks like they were not werewolves, they were ordinary wolves. Of course, it does not really matter how many wolves there are in the forest. So, you know, but anyway, that's about it, what you can tell. But, of course, you will need to think of something now that situation is. And also one other thing, let me take a look at your character sheet.
Yep.
You don't have leadership.
With no.
Which is not a good idea. Okay, roll willpower.
Yeah, I'm rolling willpower. Motherfucker, three.
Okay.
Okay.
Okay. Well, basically, let's be honest. It's not so much your fault. I mean, you basically made it worse. Boris sent you. You didn't come here on your own volition. And whether she was whatever she was doing, just having one cavalry squadron and a mech around should be pretty much enough to scare any enemy of the revolution into either running or hiding, but basically going into it would pretty much ruin her stealth approach anyway, almost surely. So if you want to go into argument with her, you may point out that it's not so much Boris, so much your fault as it is Boris's.
And
since Boris is technically the boss of all three of you, it's not so much your fault.
Yeah, I'm just a... Yeah, she kind of stormed off right now, so she's running towards a direction very angry, and I'm like looking towards this.
Yeah, but we can fast forward to the moment when she kind of settles down.
Yeah. Okay. And he approaches her.
And either way, you will have to salvage situation one way or the other. I mean, if there is actually a warlock around here, and if he actually can summon, create whatever, werewolves, you definitely need to... Well, that's debatable, but kill him, interrogate him, or both. I mean, you know.
Yeah, but I need Jeremiah for that, because he has a lot of bigger force to scour up all of the forest, even though he basically, the warlock himself, would have changed hideouts within the forest by this time. So I need a bigger, I mean, not so much bigger, but larger amount of people.
Okay. But Jeremiah is back at the village, and she's here. And basically we need to move story forward, so...
So, yeah, he'd be... I don't have a flare. And I don't know, smokes. No, they wouldn't know it.
Okay.
So he'd approach her and say, okay, we acted rashly, but Boris is the one that actually sent me with my mech and my comrade with his whole squad to search for you, because you haven't reported in some time now. He was worried about...
Motherfucker! He's just as dumb as you are. How many of you are there anyway?
Most of the main force is in the village, about 30 strong.
Fuck the shit! That means that before we find them, they're gonna lose at least 5 of them, maybe more. Fuck the shit. Okay, listen. Go back to the village and warn them. And I'll see if he can... if he decides to run for it.
Okay.
Roll willpower again.
Okay. Rolling will again. 0.
She's just trying to eliminate you, to have all the glory for herself.
That's fine. He doesn't care, but he would be going back to the village to report it to his immediate superior, because that is standard military protocol.
Okay, works for me. Anyway, by the time you return, it's gonna be an evening. Luke, do you wanna do something important in the village?
Essentially, all he'd be doing is setting up places to hide behind. Not like to be like, oh, there's a werewolf, run, hide, but the setup to shoot behind.
Okay, I understand you are fortifying the village, basically.
Yep.
Okay, it works. There's not much to tell. So basically, the evening is and Cello returns.
Yeah. You can see the Big Mac coming back to the village. And he'd be searching for you in particular. So.
Okay, you're not... You don't have much problem finding him. I mean, I suppose, Luke, when you hear the mech approaching, you're going to ride out or something.
Yeah, I'll ride out to meet him and see how he went.
Okay. Role play, guys.
Okay. Hello, comrade. I bring news.
Good news, I hope.
Yes and no. Let's walk a bit. He jumps out of the mech. Because this might contains a bit of sensitive information. And while we are walking, he continues, the good news is, I found Lily.
No. And the bad news?
She was tracking our enemies that somehow learned how to create... these monsters, rolls his eyes on the monster a bit, but because of, my overzealousness to actually eliminate the threat in a timely manner and without any casualties, the enemy has... changed its base within the forest, and Lily went out after him again.
They're basically on the run. You may want to tell him that.
Yes, they are on the run, basically. So, orders?
Jeremiah gets out the vodka bottle from his pocket again.
Okay, Jeremiah, you wanna get one fate point back?
Sure.
Okay, well, you've been drinking vodka for a while, if you know what I mean.
I know exactly what you mean out of character. I know exactly.
Okay, so basically it's, let's just say Jeremiah is under the influence.
Especially if he has the good stuff.
And also night is coming.
So, what are our orders now?
Look, it's up to you.
Jeremiah looks at his comrade, and he's standing. He's not doing too well standing, but he's standing. When he pulls the bottle out from his pocket, it's empty. He looks at it. Sighs, puts it back in his pocket, and he says, one minute, and he quickly runs to a tree nearby and takes a leak, so to speak.
Okay.
Kelu looks at his mech, admires the beauty that he has built and recrafted, and he's lost in his thoughts until his superior returns.
Okay.
All right.
Do you want to have werewolves grab you and take you to their lair?
Sure.
Okay, well, this will be the cliffhanger, and this will be the place, perfect place to end. So it's just like in the stupid movies, you get dragged off by the werewolves while you're taking a leak. And we'll continue the story in a week. Anyway, this will be it for this week. And we'll work on that on the story later. There was, I can actually stop broadcasting now, and I will do so, but I'm gonna ask Flavio to stay on a bit, because I need a bit of help. I had a problem with chat. Since I dropped out of Hangout for a moment, my chat got erased, so I need him to repost important parts, especially the Q&A part, somewhere where I can save it into the Suntec file. Okay, anyway, thanks for playing, and we will be continue with the adventure of Mary Communists and the Max. So much for the week.